My name is Charles Collins. I'm a musician. I'm a drummer. I'm originally from Chicago, Illinois. I grew up on the south side of Chicago, and I went to DuSable High School, where I was. My band director was Captain Walter Diet, and he was well respected as a musician for training musicians. In fact, a lot of band leaders would come and choose members of our jazz band to play with them. And I started playing drums my second year of high school. By my third year, I was doing gigs professionally. By my fourth year, I recorded my first record. It was with an artist named Gene Chandler, and I played on The Girl Don't Care. Wasn't that much interested in doing sessions then, because it seemed like being in school, it was studious-like, and I liked playing out more because it was more fun. Learned to change that a little bit. Eventually, I joined a group named the Constellations, who were moving to New York, and that was exciting. I definitely wanted to do that. And we moved there, and we did gigs with Dionne Warwick, and we did gigs alone. And for a quick minute, I played with Dionne. Eventually the band broke up and I started doing sessions in New York. I walked into a recording session one time and Bernard Purdy was on drums, Eric Yale on guitar, Richie T on piano, and Chuck Graney on bass. I heard them play their first song and I wanted to go back home. But I stayed. I met the guys from Antesia Music, Ralph McDonald, Bill Salter, Bill Eden. They wrote Where's the Love. Became friends with them, and they turned me on to music and turned me on to the music scene there in New York by introducing me to different acts and recommending me to play on different gigs. I worked with Ashford and Simpson, recorded with them, Herbie Mann, as well as Robin Kenyatta, recorded a lot for Atlantic Records. And so that was really a great learning period for me, and I enjoyed it quite a bit. Then I got a call to play live with a group called Duke Williams and the Extremes out of Philadelphia. So I went and auditioned for them, and everything worked out well. And they said, we want you to move to Philly. There's an apartment, you don't have to pay rent. And that sounded really good. So I moved there and only stayed in the apartment in Philadelphia for 2 days because I didn't like the apartment. But one of the members of the band lived in Hopewell, New Jersey. It was out in the country, it was beautiful, it was peaceful. I moved there. Worked with Duke Williams in Extremes. We recorded a album called Fantastic Fedora, where we recorded it in Sigma Sound, and I met a lot of the players there. At that time, the rhythm section was Baker Harrison Young, and they were amazing. They had already played on a lot of hits out of Philadelphia. So I worked for different production companies there. I started playing hand percussion, which I learned a lot in high school, and also from Ralph McDonald, Kibasa, tambourine, calaves, bell trees. Worked for WMOT production, and eventually Baker Harrison Young started their own production company, and I worked for them as well, and had the opportunity to work next to the great Earl Young, playing hand percussion and stuff. And every once in a while, I'd get an opportunity to play drums on things. And as you know, I was still very much a drummer. And then they became really, really busy with their own production company. And I moved into the drum seat with Michael Foreman as the bass player. I moved into the drum seat for Gamble and Huff. Michael Foreman was a bass player. Dennis Harris was a guitarist. And of course, Huff played piano, and Larry Washington played congas. And then I moved from that, and I got the Tom Bell account as well as Gamble and Huff. And that was Bob Babbitt on bass, Anthony Bell, Tony Bell on guitar, Bobby Eli on guitar, and of course, Tom Bell playing piano. And every once in a while, a very good friend of mine, George Merrill, played synth. So I had those two accounts in Philly, and that was very, very, you know, good for me. Those were the prestigious account. And then Lou Rawls came to town, and we recorded him recorded You'll Never Find, which was a record that I'm noted for because of it. It was a different groove for Philadelphia. I played an ostinato on the floor tom, on the rim of the floor tom. And when I started doing that, the engineer was Joe Tarsia. He ran out, mic'd the drums differently. Michael, as I said, Michael Foreman played bass on that. Dennis Harris played guitar. And it was a different groove, and everybody liked it, and it sounded great. And then when we heard Lou Rawls go, You'll Never Find, everyone knew that that was a hit record. Well, that helped my career a lot. I'm very proud of playing on that song, because ultimately I ended up then doing sessions back in New York because of that song. And in fact, I even went as far as Brazil to record, and out in California. In Philadelphia, we did the OJs. As I said, Lou Rawls, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, Teddy Pendergrass, Gene Karn, and that's just to mention a few. And then the Jacksons came in. We did them. We did their first album after leaving Motown. We did Dionne Warwick. And with Tom Bell, we recorded Elton John. And this was just an exciting, very exciting part of my life, and recording with different people and having the music be successful. Things sort of slowed down, moving into the 80s. The Magnificent Drum Machine came in, which I thought would never make it, and now I have quite a few of them. And that's the thing I'd like to say to a lot of young drummers, learn the technology. It is amazing. It is great that I had the opportunity to play on a lot of the earlier records, you know, back in the 70s that were hits and everything. We really made those records. I definitely embrace the technology now. It's really wonderful. So young drummers, learn that. And also learn to meet, go out to open mics and meet songwriters, because those are going to be the people that are going to help your career a lot. Songwriters, go and meet them, play for them for nothing. Learn how they put their songs together, how they compose their songs. That will help you to build yourself as a studio musician, or just as a musician in general, knowing how people put songs together, even if you're not a songwriter. Those things are basically what led to me being inducted into the Musicians Hall of Fame. I wasn't no big, I'm going to do this. I didn't have a plan. Those things just fell into place for me in my life. And that's why I can tell you that's what works. Being inducted into the Hall of Fame sort of validates my life, because all I've ever done is play music. And I was there inducted with Earl Young from the Sound of Philadelphia, Dennis Harris, Jimmy Williams, the whole Baker Harrison Young rhythm section was inducted. They were the first guys. And Joe Torsia, who certainly helped a whole lot in putting the songs together. I owe him a lot for Mike and You'll Never Find for me. One of the most important things in playing music is your ears. You need your ears very, very badly. So you need to protect your ears, but you also need to hear everything that's around you. So I use these babies, Extreme Isolation. They let you hear everything. They isolate exactly what you want to hear. You hear your drums, you hear the bass, you hear the guitar, and the melody being played by the piano as well as the rhythm, and everything that's around you, but it's not overpowering, and it's not so many dBs that you have to turn it up so loud. You don't have to turn it up so loud to hear everything clearly while you're playing, because it isolates your playing, so more of you is actually coming through your phones as opposed to trying to hear it, the live sound. So protect your ears and get the best, and the best are Extreme Isolation, direct sound. Some of the highlights of my career, again, was playing on You'll Never Find. It was exciting doing Elton John's record that Tom Bell produced. And just being a part of something where everyone was working together. The Sound of Philadelphia was definitely a sound, but it was a bunch of musicians and songwriters all working together and all with one purpose, and that's to make really, really good music. I mean, I would come to work in the morning and there was a board and it would tell you who was coming in to record. The OJs, Teddy Pendergrass, Hal Melvin and the Blue Notes, Billy Paul, the Stylistics, the Spinners, the Jacksons, they'd all be coming in, and I knew that I would be a part on that, if not play the whole album, be a part of playing a great deal of that album. Those were the highlights, and seeing those things and being part of it. I felt like I belonged to something that meant something. I mean, I could record a song, and a month or so later, I could hear it being played as I'm driving down the pike, the New Jersey Turnpike, to play on something else. Those there were tons of highlights, in my career, and working with people that I respected, and artists that also showed respect for us, and ultimately getting the credit for it, and knowing that you're appreciated. As I said, the Musicians Hall of Fame just validated my life, and I'm so proud to have been a part of the Sound of Philadelphia and belonging to something that was so powerful in the music industry. At present, I'm doing my own CD, and I've completed 7.5 songs. I've done quite a bit of it at my house, and also at the house of Josh Good, who I work with. He and I have a lot of the same equipment, and I record horns and vocals at Audio Dallas in Dallas. I'm really excited about finishing it up and getting it out there. I'm proud of the music, and a lot of it is written by me and Josh, and George Merle, a great, good friend of mine. And we do some covers. And a couple of covers are songs. One song I recorded in Philly, and one song I wish I had have recorded in Philly. So I look forward to those things being released, and I hope you as well look forward. And don't forget, protect those ears.